Hello, good evening. Welcome to the New School. My name is Amanda Palmer. I'm the assistant curator of the Verilis Center for Art and Politics here at the New School. I'm delighted to welcome you to another season of Public Art Fund Talks. We're pleased and grateful to be working with the Public Art Fund in presenting the series this spring. This joint initiative between the Public Art Fund and the Verilis Center for Art and Politics conceives of New York City as an urban campus, as an artist studio, and importantly, as a commons. The Public Art Fund's commitment to art in the public realm and the Verilis Center's embrace of art as a political expression encourage a dynamic platform for artists and publics to reflect on contemporary issues. Before we begin, let me briefly mention our next upcoming event at the Verilis Center, part of our biannual thematic programming, which is currently focused on post-democracy. This Thursday afternoon, we will be presenting a panel discussion and exhibition entitled Indigeneity Stacks Sovereignty, which considers new shapes of community building and the capacity of these new relations to undermine the traditional sovereignty of the nation state. For the afternoon presentation, artist Nabutaka Aozaki, who has recently participated in the Queen's Museum Studio Program, and Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture, will be speaking with media theorist Benjamin Bratton about his practice of mapping space and social relations. Bratton will then join us in the evening panel for a series of presentations and discussions with anthropologist Jaskiran Dillon and artist Tyler Coburn and Adelita Husni Bey, moderated by artist Daniel Sauter. More information about our events are in your program and on the Verilis Center website. Now, I'm delighted to welcome to the stage Daniel Palmer, who will introduce Liz Glynn, but also I just want to thank you all very much for being here, and thanks as well to the Public Art Fund.
Good evening. I'm Daniel S. Palmer, Associate Curator at Public Art Fund. Thank you all for joining us tonight, and thank you to Liz Glynn for speaking in Public Art Fund's spring season of talks at the New School, organized in collaboration with the Verilis Center for Art and Politics. We had a great talk last time with artists from Commercial Break, and we look forward to having Anish Kapoor speak here on May 3rd. Liz Glynn's talk this evening coincides with her Public Art Fund commission titled Open House. The installation opens tomorrow at Doris C. Freedman Plaza, which is at the southeast entrance of Central Park. It is an open-air ballroom of cast concrete arches, sofas, chairs, and footstools with sculpted additions, and it references the now-demolished William C. Whitney Mansion, one of the grandest and most opulent Fifth Avenue buildings, designed by Gilded Age architect Stanford White, that stood 8 blocks north of the plaza. The artist invites the public to enjoy a previously exclusive interior space that she has made open and accessible to all. Glynn's piece is formally compelling, but it also thoughtfully engages with the city's history and pressing social questions that confront urban metropolises today. I hope you'll see it and enjoy it soon. This is the artist's first large-scale public commission, but continues her ongoing interest in social ritual, class, and the dynamics between public and private space. We're thrilled to be able to provide a platform like this for such an ambitious, accomplished artist as Liz to share her visionary approach to sculpture with New York City. Liz has had numerous solo shows and performances in recent years. These include her most recent exhibition at Paula Cooper Gallery this winter, and also I'd like to thank Paula and the gallery for their support of the exhibition. Liz's other solo shows include those at prestigious venues such as the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, Sculpture Center, the Museum of Contemporary Art Los Angeles, and she has also been included in exhibitions at the Barbican, the Hammer Museum, and the New Museum. Glynn is a recipient of several awards, including a Creative Capital Foundation Fellowship and the Center for Cultural Innovations Investing in Artists Grant. She is currently based in Los Angeles and received a BA in Visual Art and Environmental Studies at Harvard University and an MFA from California Institute of the Arts. Please join me in welcoming Liz to the stage, and I hope you'll think of some good questions to ask her when we open it up to the audience at the end of her talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dan. And thank you to everyone at the Public Art Fund. None of these projects happen with the work of only one person, and it takes a village, as you will see. Okay, here we go. Here's the piece. I'm going to talk about Open House, the work for the Public Art Fund, at the end of the talk, but I want to take you through some other work first. So, much of my work uses monumental architecture and epic historical narratives to think about the potential for change in the present tense. In 2008, I made my first participatory performance, which was called the 24-Hour Roman Reconstruction Project, or Building Rome in a Day. The project was developed during the later Bush years, when the cliche, Rome wasn't built in a day, was the administration's excuse for why we couldn't rebuild Iraq, Afghanistan, or New Orleans. I wanted to ask the sort of stupid question, what would happen if we tried? So I worked with a coalition of the willing, working approximately 1.23 years per minute on a timeline from 753 BC to 410 AD, ending in the sacking of Rome at the hands of the Visigoths. In this instance, in LA, led by my barbarian. What fascinated me in this performance is the same people who were harmoniously working together just minutes before are also the people that ebulliently destroy the city at the end. There's not only a pleasure in the ruin, but the pleasure in the act of ruining. The piece was also presented at the New Museum as part of their first triennial. This piece was first conceived during the last months of Bush, but this performance happened about 3 months into the Obama administration, and it took on a different, more optimistic tone. And I'll return to this notion of context later in discussing Open House. In 2010, I constructed Three, which was a pyramid made of 600 reclaimed forklift pallets in Los Angeles. When I moved to LA, I could no longer make sculpture out of a lot of the materials I was using in New England and New York, old architectural fragments with peeling paint. Los Angeles has a fundamentally different relationship to architecture. I grew up outside of Boston, where every brick has a piece of history and every space is spoken for. And in LA, there was a lot of unclaimed space, or it felt like there was a different sense of possibility. Los Angeles has a mentality of constant renovation, and if I wanted my objects to have any history, I had to construct it myself, which frequently happened through performance. The forklift pallets themselves bear the traces of anonymous commerce, but it's a history that goes largely unrecorded. So for this pyramid, I hosted 9 performances around irrational fear, desire, and the financial crisis. Guests were all invited through a pyramid scheme in which every invitation stated, you must bring a guest, and all invitations were distributed through the postal service. Each performance took a theme from the Egyptian Book of the Dead, refashioned around something about the financial crisis. For the first performance, Coming Forth by Day, I invited a group of 9 friends to come for lunch, discuss their irrational fears, and take sedatives to sleep into the evening. That night, a group of wakers appointed by the sleepers, sleeping here, came to a site about half a mile away, took flashlights with maps out of a bucket, and walked half a mile downhill to open the door of the pyramid and read back our irrational fears in the negative. I'm not afraid of cancer, I'm not afraid of going insane, I'm not afraid of dying from the bacteria of edible arrangements, and so forth. I took a lot of risks that I hadn't taken during these performances, including combining references, historical and contemporary. I'd also never taken sedatives, though we had a registered nurse on hand supervising us. I'm told it took about 8 minutes to wake me up. I also went to college with someone who'd worked for Madoff and Associates, and I was reintroduced to him on New Year's Eve after Madoff had been indicted. So this performance was entitled On Not Seeing Corruption, which is a role play interview in which the audience is blindfolded to conceal the identity of the interviewee as I asked questions about his relationship to corruption. A 7-foot-long boa constrictor was passed through the audience. I should also mention that I am terrified of snakes. All things change, and we change with them. The pyramid was deconstructed at the end in the sort of fireman-style carry line, which I had imagined as this very elegant performance, like a funeral march, except that we were interrupted twice, once by the fire department for the height of our barbecue, and a second time by the police wanting to show their friends where this thing they had found on the hill existed. So I'm interested in this notion of how these monuments shift over time, how their meanings changed. When I visited the Great Pyramids in 2012, even King Menkaure's pyramid was being refurbished in a sense so that the steps were made more clear to mimic our historic idea of what it should look like and preserve it. So the notion of preservation and what gets preserved and what gets left behind is also central to my work. And I often use objects to trace shifts in cultural value. So I often also use materials that highlight some aspect of the object that I'm seeking to trace. These are the California surrogates for the Getty, which are 40 sculptures made of trash and materials used to duplicate sculpture, wax, plaster. When I moved to Southern California, I was fascinated by the strange relationship that California has to antiquity, embodied in the Getty Villa, J. Paul Getty's recreation of the Villa dei Pamperi from Herculaneum on the Malibu coast with frescoes that were done in the 2000s, but juxtaposing authentic classical sculpture with recent copies, or Hearst Castle, where he would take a fragment of a 15th century ceiling and have a California artisan complete it to fill the master bedroom. Also interested in the idea of desire in relationship to the object. I never set out to make works based on classical sculpture, and it ended up being something that sort of happened accidentally in graduate school when I was flipping through an issue of Art News, and I saw this image of a 4th century gold funerary wreath, and I thought, what is that? I want that. And apparently a lot of other people did, because the object was being returned by the Getty to Greece as part of a reconciliation agreement around cultural property. It had been acquired against the UNESCO cultural conventions prohibiting the illegal export of antiquities. This work, the Euphronius crater, which showed at Paula Cooper in 2012, is an object, copy of an object that was held at the Met when a curator said, let's make a work of classical sculpture go for above $1 million, as a Monet painting recently had before. And they did this by assigning authorship to the Euphronius crater, the painter Euphronius. And when curators saw this work on site, they talked about falling in love with it and having these long, elaborate lunches in the Italian countryside and kind of losing all ethical judgment. I think about these works as inherently dynamic. So in 2012, I did a project activating the context, the notion of a surrogate in context, tracing the movement of a group of artifacts known as the Gold of Troy, which were discovered by Heinrich Schliemann, an American entrepreneur turned archaeologist, who set out to prove that Homer's Iliad, the epic poem, actually happened, which is a beautiful poetic idea and completely wrongheaded historical notion. So these are stills from a video. Shot starting in Berlin at the Neues Museum, where I'm standing in front of a display case containing actual copies of the Gold of Troy. Schliemann illegally excavated the gold in Greece, in Turkey, and then spirited away illegally, donated to the German people, and then during World War II, the gold was taken by the Russians and later appeared in the Pushkin Museum in the 90s. So this gold is, they're copies that suggest that the Germans actually want their gold back. But the question is, what, it's a copy of what? It's not actually King Priam's gold, as Schliemann would like you to think it is. These are the copies that I made of the gold on a double-sided display case similar to the Neues Museum. One copy is bronze, gold-plated bronze. The other is paper, but copies of what? And I'm kind of interested in this notion of the bottomless nature of history, the idea that we never know, but also the power of the declarative, the fact that by Schliemann saying, this is Priam's gold, and I'm going to take a photograph of my wife wearing this gold diadem, somehow makes it real and makes it valuable in a way that just finding a random chunk of gold in the ground wasn't necessarily until he added the narrative to it. This is the exhibition of the works. Along the way, I shot a video on the Dardanelles, the strait where the Trojan War was fought. And I think a lot about cycles of history, the way that ancient things happen and come back and repeat themselves. I think about this maybe a lot in today's political moment. This is an early cast concrete work that I wanted to show in relation to the work at the Public Art Fund. It's called the Untitled War Memorial after Treptow. And while I was in Berlin working on the video, I came across this pile of flowers at the Soviet War Memorial in Treptow Park, which I thought was kind of the best war memorial ever. The sculptures in this park are incredibly posthuman in scale. They're these massive, like 30, 40 foot tall Soviet figurative sculptures. And these flowers had accumulated after the day of Soviet remembrance, but by a generation that could not have possibly lived through the events that the memorial was memorializing. My first impulse as a sculptor was to cast this, but I was 6 weeks away from home. I had no idea where to get trash bags on a Sunday in Treptow, and I was skeptical about the legality of shipping rotting flowers through international customs. So I took about 300 photographs and recreated the pile in the studio, at which point I started pouring a lot of silicone onto the pile to try to create this mold. But the flowers died under the mold, and the resulting piece, this is just one of six blocks, ends up looking bombed. But I thought that was sort of an appropriate metaphor, thinking about the impossibility of preserving history or preserving our first-person memory of it. I also use concrete in the context of this piece, thinking about Eastern Bloc architecture, thinking about this architecture of the people and the way that it's used often in public parks. Another cast concrete piece that I created in 2011 was sited in this Le Corbusier building, Corbusier's only building in North America, which happens to be the Carpenter Center for the Visual Arts at Harvard. It is on a campus that's primarily populated by this traditional Ivy League brick and mortar architecture. And at the time, the Fogg Museum adjacent was under renovation by Renzo Piano. So I was able, working with the staff at the Carpenter Center, to get bricks from the Fogg renovation and cast them into these concrete chairs after Le Corbusier's LC2 chair. These chairs aren't typically sat on, but they're using the steel and chrome frames, thinking about the idea of the museum or the modern architecture cannibalizing the older brick and mortar. The piece is called On the Museum's Ruin. I work a lot also with performance and thinking about the way that objects can be activated through performative actions. This is the poster for a series of three performances at MoCA in Los Angeles after about 1 or 2 years after MoCA faced near financial collapse and brought in a new director. A lot of people felt betrayed by the museum at some point at this point in time, and the U in the title is MoCA. Loving You is Like Fucking the Dead is the title of the piece. This was the poster that we sent that could arrive in your two-year-old's mailbox. I wanted to ask the question of how you could engage with a museum that might feel dead to you in some sense, and I went back to the utopic 19th century model of the museum, the Crystal Palace. So this is a steel frame effigy. It's about 16 by 12 by 8. It created and worked with Hollywood pyrotechnicians offsite to create a video of the effigy, which would then be activated as a performance of the charred remains on the grounds of MoCA's Grand Avenue campus. This is an early instance of me trying to do something that in normal institutional context is just not possible. I would have liked to burn it on site. Anyhow, I worked with a percussionist, Corey Fogel, who's a frequent collaborator, creating a three-part performance, mining the charred remains, based on Paul Sheerbart's novel, The Gray Cloth and 10% White, this kind of techno-utopic architectural novel where he talks about painting the world with colored glass. These pieces of colored glass came out from under the charred ruins and were created a sort of human-powered kaleidoscope. Then I broke 68 pieces of colored glass to create a dance floor on a light box, which we performed Chopin's Last Waltz. The following two performances were a blindfolded performance of the museum entitled Like a Patient Etherized Upon a Table or MoCA Goes Dark, where the security guards would navigate, the guests would navigate to the sound of the security guards jangling keys, sometimes holding hands with a stranger or a friend, asking questions about mortality. What is the length of the life of an institution? What is the length of your own life? And what is the relationship between the two? And And finally, we ended in a cathartic 9-course dinner staged around a sacrificial lamb, butchered with the help of Matthew Poli, Heirloom LA, who helped create a menu that included performative interventions throughout the meal. I thought a lot about kind of the relationship between the human body, a single body, and monumental architecture. How many people did it take to build the pyramids? What can one person build? I'm constantly facing my own limits in terms of what I think I can manage to build myself and realizing that I need more help. This is a piece from Performa in 2011 when I set out to recreate Buckminster Fuller's decidedly unmonumental attempt to make a full-size geodesic dome out of Venetian blind slatting at Black Mountain College. This was done in the summer of 1948, and for Performa, I staged this work on 3 sites, but perhaps the most radical juxtaposition between Fuller's slow, quiet, utopic architecture was that of Times Square, where he had this very posthuman, highly mediated architectural environment. The piece is a durational work of about 45 minutes, and sort of existed in this very busy urban fabric. I also think about the logistics of large objects moving and sort of the capital flows behind them. I created 2 obelisks that were about 20 feet in length for the De Cordova Sculpture Park. These were erected with human labor, thinking about, so we used a system of pulleys and a group of volunteers in the museum to put them up in the park, but thinking about the era when obelisks were moved out of Egypt to Italy, to Britain, to Paris, and to New York in Central Park. One of these is based on one of the Cleopatra's needles, which you may have seen behind the Metropolitan. And what drove people to invest in this motion? I went to Egypt in 2011, several months after the Egyptian Revolution, and it was this time of great possibility, and many of the Egyptians I spoke with talked about the revolution as the next great moment in Egypt after the time of the pharaohs. I was invited to make a work for a biennial called Made in LA, and I've always felt that my work didn't necessarily conform to a stereotypically Californian aesthetic. So I wanted to mark this moment in time, but also question the notion of what exactly Made in LA might mean. The entrance of this piece is deliberately obfuscating, except through the hole in the wall you see there's sort of the suggestion something else might be inside, in this case a box of white museum gloves. Then 2 sculptural tunnels flank the room. On the left-hand side, this is Passage Giza Gaza, which was created after a drawing made by Napoleon Savants inside the tunnels of the Great Pyramids. Think about the metaphor between the passage of the idea of the tunnels inside the pyramids as being the journey to the afterlife in relation to the tunnels, the smuggling tunnels at the time that were proliferating between Egypt and the Gaza Strip in order to allow normal everyday life to function. There's also a cabinet on the left-hand side that's part of a work called Anonymous Needs and Desires, pictured here on the left. The cast concrete tunnel on the right is based on one of the smuggling tunnels between Egypt and the Gaza border. And all of the drawers of this cabinet contain different objects made of cast lead or resin and Kevlar. The lead is very heavy material, but the lead referred to the Operation Cast Lead, the Israeli military operation, which caused the border security to contract significantly. And all of these works, similar to Open House, were made through a process of casting, but in this case using metal. So you see, you can see a little bit at the top of that baby food. I deliberately, in a lot of the works, leave the marks of the casting process visible so that they aren't perfect objects. It's clear that they've been made in some fashion. One of my favorite, I guess, objects in this series is the bottom left. It's a set of pills known as tramadol, which is a flu medicine in the West, but in the Gaza Strip is something people take as a recreational drug just to be able to deal with the stress of living there. One other aspect of this piece. Viewers in the museum exhibition were encouraged to take the objects out of the drawers and handle them, perhaps the gloves or not, and sort of experience the notion of smuggling. I signed an unorthodox exhibition waiver to allow for the security guard to be outside of the area with the drawers so that you had a private experience of the space. This is kind of when it was cleaned up, but I would go back about every 2 weeks to reset, as many of the objects would have been kind of littering the floor. I created a series of performances for LACMA in 2013. And originally I wanted to respond to their collection of minimalist sculpture. And the cycle of performances was entitled Delusions of Grandeur, Monumentality, and Other Myths, loosely based on some of the questions that people have. I go to museums often with my dad when we're in town together, and he'll have questions like walking up to a Richard Serra sculpture and holding up his credit card and saying, "That's a lot of steel. I think only like one place in the world could make that." He's an engineer. And like, yes, well, there were two and now there's actually one. But in talking to him about questions that he has that are seemingly dumb questions, they're actually quite revealing as to the nature of how these sculptures come into the world and what goes into making them. So I had no interest in figurative sculpture when I started this project, and LACMA happens to have a significant collection of Rodin works donated by the Cantor Foundation, and I thought in passing I should just do my due diligence because I work in a research-based way and I should look up this Rodin guy. And I completely fell in love with Rodin's process. This performance was called The Myth of Singularity, and thinking about Rodin not as sort of one of the totemic great men of modern sculpture, but this meant artists that worked out of fragments, would collage fragments together, that one of his most famous works, The Monument to Balzac, when it was originally debuted at the Paris Salon, was completely panned. So I wanted to create a performance around this notion of failure and fragmentation. And working with the curator, José Luis Blondet, and the conservation staff at LACMA, I got permission to take fragmentary molds of the sculptures in the collection and then use those molds working to recreate Rodin's atelier process in the garden at LACMA. Over a two-day performance, we built up 8 figurative sculptures. The other performances in the series included The Myth of Getting It Right the First Time, a play on LACMA's historic Bing Theater based on the commissioning of Alexander Calder's first large-scale fountain, Hello Girls. The play quickly becomes a comedy of errors as the dancers who are playing the sculpture have to be reinstalled, deinstalled. The sculpture is almost destroyed for about 5 cycles of its near death. But what was interesting to me is the women on the left, the girls in the piece of Calder's title, Hello Girls, the women who commissioned the piece were actually quite involved with it coming to LACMA, and LACMA had saved all of the correspondence, which became the script for the piece. So we have these long letters written from the head of their art museum council, written and Calder replying these short handwritten postcards. Thinking about this in the context of a public artwork today for me is interesting because Calder was not an engineer, and a lot of the engineering flaws of his work became readily evident as the piece was on view and the arms of the piece started flying off and becoming projectiles. So, cautionary tale. I also think about the relationship between permanent and impermanent materials. This is Tony Smith's Smoke in the Foreground, and then a performance I did called The Myth of Pure Form. The Tony Smith work was originally made out of plywood for the Corcoran Scale as Content exhibition, and I recreated it, or the plywood members, and dissected them in this sort of dance performance, thinking about the notion of organic geometry, but also the temporality of the material rather than the much more permanent refabrication in aluminum. Much of which has happened posthumously in the case of Smith. And also actually in the case of many of the artists we're talking about, so Rodin as well, many of the works were never, or maybe only once cast in bronze until before he was dead. So last performance was The Myth of Permanent Material, based on a cast concrete Donald Judd work, which you can actually see the top and bottom of. There's a work, or actually just the top, sorry, the top of that is a Judd, a work of five cast concrete works done in a single pour, but badly executed under the supervision of the Ace Gallery in the collection of LACMA. In the records at LACMA, there's a note that suggested perhaps these works should be refabricated because they were in such bad condition that if you attempt to move them, you might destroy them completely. And I created a performance sort of asking, what if we just set up the formwork and went about the process and just did it? We could, right? Except that it sets the same set of problems potentially in motion again, and the Judd being singular in how it was made is inherently unique. So I was able to consult with the museum director to find out the intended fate of the Judd, which is supposedly to try to preserve it at any cost. So this formwork at the end of this rather unmonumental performance, we had a concrete truck in the waiting. The concrete truck pulled up, and then I explained the logical conclusion. The concrete truck drove away, and the formwork disappeared. So not everything ends in a large monumental sculpture. I think also a lot about motion. This is Vessel, Ravage, Looted, and Burn, which was installed in a temporary space with Paula Cooper Gallery in 2014. I was thinking a lot about the history of piracy, about the history of the British piracy during the time of the Dutch East India Company and a lot of naval colonial trading, but then also the recent rise in Somali piracy and the fact that both came up in response to political situations. The sculpture was activated in a performance with four opera singers who converged around it, thinking about the idea instead of like a siren song in reverse, where four opera singers came by ferry and then walking, humming a different soprano or, a different dramatic aria, or in one case, a Somali pirate ransom letter, and converged around the ship on a dark and stormy night. The idea of the object drawing the women who were active forces to it rather than the women causing the ship to end in ruin. It's another way of thinking about the copy. I started making all of these copies of objects that either had been recovered from shipwrecks that I had photographic or journalistic accounts of, like these Ming Dynasty porcelain plates recovered from the South China Sea in the foreground, or copies that I sort of invented based on literary accounts from the pirates. A lot of the accounts of the history of the period of piracy are thought to be largely bravado, fabricated. So on the left, you have Julius Caesar's purple robes. You have a black suit that was stolen off someone's back as they were trying to sell some clothing on the shoreside. I'll flip through a few of these. Busts, a Punic War era battering ram, the Anthakira mechanism, which has been reconstructed as a perfect brass timekeeping device, but when it was found, it looked like this, these almost bits of nothingness. This is a show that followed soon after called Ransom Room at Sculpture Center. I often think about my relationship to history as one of tracing, and in this case, I was inspired by a passing reference to Pizarro's conquest of the Inca Empire. This is a vision of the Inca Emperor's palace in Cusco, paneled with walls of gold, in this case, red sculpture wax coated with gold mica powder, and this fabled corn, the gold corn, in the middle of the room. The panels were cast and powder coated. The red sculpture wax is what you would use in bronze casting. As the story goes, Pizarro went to what is now Peru and captured the Inca Emperor and held him ransom for a room the size of the gallery that we resized at Sculpture Center, 14 by 21 feet, once over with gold and twice with silver, to the height of his outstretched hand. And the ransom was hand-carried from the far corners of the empire. So I thought about this in the context of Sculpture Center, whose stuff at this point, or in the context of New York, whose stuff would be destroyed and whose stuff would be melted down and not end up valued and put on display in a museum. So I think about all of the IKEA junk in the outer boroughs. I did think about the option of melting down scrap metal for this piece, but for a lot of OSHA-related reasons, it was not possible. But with the help of a number of nonprofits, including Pioneer Works, Cabinet, other spaces, I cast, it worked for about a month, casting the ransom as much as I could carry in the outer boroughs, and then I would carry it by hand, walking with these kind of granny bags. The second you put anything into one of those bags, it is not art, and no one cares, and you are disgusting. This is me taking it on the subway. And the ransom accumulated over the course of a month or so, and then at the end it was melted down. The Spanish held a mock trial, executed the emperor, and then melted down all of the artifacts, which held no financial value for the Inca, only ritual value, and effectively destroyed a highly functional egalitarian society. The ingots were subsequently divided up into different pieces depending on how the ransom had been divided amongst the conquistadors. This is to Hernando de Soto, 14 ingots. So they did not keep a record of what they melted, but they did keep careful records of how much everyone got. This is a series of masks that I created thinking about the notion of pathos and the relationship between the hand and kind of how our relationship to emotion manifests physically, or in how stress manifests in the contemporary body. I mention these in part because there's a bit of hand sculpting in the open house piece, which I'll talk about momentarily, but in these works, they're all blind gestural exercises, so I actually press the clay against my face and manipulate it rather than sculpting it by eye. Just going to return briefly to the work from the myth of singularity at LACMA, which resulted in 8 plaster pieces like this, which were then cast in bronze. This is at LACMA on view. The process of bronze casting for some people requires just dropping something up off at the foundry and showing up months later. And when I went first to the foundry to review the waxes, they felt dead, and I was worried that I'd done something really wrong by deciding to go about the process of casting them in bronze. But what I figured out was to get all the detail that I wanted in the pieces, it was going to take months of being there in the foundry to recreate every little tiny thread and all the messiness of the performance, like the fact that this arm dropped by about a foot because it was badly wired on, or to get all of these details of the different drips and everything. I keep a PDF of about 178 pages, and we go over every detail in wax before the pieces are cast. These are some of the works on view at LACMA, at the Petit Palais. Depending on where they're on view, it changes the work quite a bit. Here's the work most recently at Paula Cooper Gallery, and it was, for me, it was nice to see them in just a blank space. Wanted to just mention this one, and I forgot to add one more slide, but there's, in a lot of the work, as I mentioned, I leave evidence of the casting process. So on the side of his hand, I know there's a parting line from Rodin, and in Rodin's work, he often left marks from like the smear of a finger or the evidence of where the work was cast, particularly in the plaster works. And this is something that you see in a lot of the works that I make. There's a lot of hand in it, which I think about not as my masterful hand at all, because I don't think my hands are especially skilled and actually barely trust them to do anything, but rather just pointing out the fact that a human made this and a human made a decision about it. So, which brings me to open house. This is a bit of a non sequitur, and I've been asked a bunch of times over the last 2 months, how did you get the idea for the piece? And the sad truth of it is I don't exactly remember. I started doing research when Nicholas and Andrew Hickey, who was formerly with the Public Art Fund, now the Cleveland Museum, approached me about doing a public art project in New York City. And I went to the obvious sources. I'm a huge JSTOR nerd, so I dug into all these texts about Frederick Law Olmsted, the history of Central Park, and so forth. But what jumped out to me really quickly was a lot of texts from the 1980s talking about the people using the park as being like vermin. And the fact that people were occupying the park was a problem. So this is my placeholder image, which is an Arlene Gottlieb photograph from 1980s. But kind of the idea that people using public space was a negative. And I started thinking about access to space. Part of why I've remained in Los Angeles for the last decade, having lived here prior to that, is simply the question of affordable space to make sculpture, but also the cost of living in different urban environments. And I think particularly as I've returned to New York for work, it's a question that has become more and more pressing every year for my friends that remain. So I began looking at the architecture and interior design of Stanford White, one-third of McKim, Mead, and White, the architects that were chosen by the top echelon of New York society during the Gilded Age, including the Morgans, the Astors, the Vanderbilts, and the Whitneys. White frequently traveled to Europe collecting this sort of pastiche of antiquities. This is actually his own home on the right-hand side in Gramercy, the exterior on the left. And he did two houses for William Collins Whitney. Whitney was married to Flora Payne, had five children, including Harry Payne Whitney, who then married Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney, who you may know as a renowned patron of the arts. So this is his house on 571 Fifth Avenue, a $3.5 million renovation commissioned by his firm for his second wife. When I was starting to think about this project, I looked at a number of different interior spaces that White had designed. What's unusual about his interior decoration, and notable about the decoration of the Gilded Age, is this was the first period in New York society where people displayed their wealth physically. Wealth had been accumulated prior to this time, but there was sort of an ethic against being especially ostentatious, and this completely disappeared during the Gilded Age. So White would travel to Europe, collect these different antiquities, and place them sort of without regard for art history into an interior. So you have this palm tree, the tapestries, this kind of Italianate table. Another view of that space is a tiger rug in it. Another space I considered using for the Public Art Fund project was the staircase at the Metropolitan Club, thinking about the image of a staircase or a ladder as something kind of emblematic of ambition. But I've always had a problem with monolithic forms, and so this felt like not exactly what I wanted to do. This space I'm absolutely in love with, and you should all go visit it because it's still open at the French Consulate. This is from the Payne-Whitney Mansion, the Venetian Room. But in terms of translating this in a public space, this opulent mirrored drawing room, I can't imagine making anything that would alter it in a way more spectacular than the original. I was reading all these novels of Edith Wharton at the time and came to the notion of the ball and the ballroom. Edith Wharton's novels of Old New York often talk about these highly choreographed courtship rituals that took place around the annual balls, the kind of coming out balls for members of New York society. And while Wharton writes a little bit of longing and desire, much of this is grounded in this very tightly orchestrated economic reality where there's a jostling for class position based on coupling. Most of these stories do not end happily. This is Carolyn Astor's ballroom. It was designed for the most exclusive 400 New Yorkers at the time, because why would you need anyone else to show up? Astor's ballroom also doubled as a picture gallery, but this ballroom, created for William Collins Whitney in his second mansion designed by White, was the first freestanding ballroom meant only to be used once a year for such a lavish event. Not also a gallery, but just once a year, this 65 by 55 foot room on Fifth Avenue. And thinking about the impossibility of for some people in the city of having even, you know, a shoebox bedroom that's 8 feet by 8 feet in an outer borough, and having this 65 by 55 foot room with double height ceilings, also a feature of Astor's ballroom. The space really captivated my imagination in some way. And so I thought about different ways to talk about this space that was incredibly exclusive, designed for the most exclusive 1,000 New Yorkers around 1901. And what I settled on was the notion of turning it into an open-air ruin, making it open to all. So the ambition for the project was very simple, to take this exclusive space and turn it over and make it open to the public and think about this question of the access to such spaces. This is the digital rendering that we've been working with for the past few months. And I always have trouble with the renderings because there's sort of no texture to them. I'm going to show you some installation photographs now from the project. None of them have been retouched as they were all shot this morning, so bear with me on the visual here. I recreated these archways based on historic photographs, and some of my original, you saw the photograph of the ballroom, and we had that rescanned from the Library of the City of New York. Unfortunately, the detail is not good enough, even scanning from the original negative, to pull a digital pattern. So I ended up redrawing all of the damask furniture or damask fabric patterns in pencil, then working with a digital assistant to correct everything before we had the patterns laser cut in chipboard to create the texture that's on the back of the different pieces. This was all glued on, my gracious studio assistant and a fleet of fantastic former UCLA students on the different pieces of furniture, which I worked on in my studio in LA. I did all this hand modeling on the edge that I think about sort of as an FU to the Baroque. They're all kind of very rough-hewn and made out of an epoxy clay. I deliberately found pieces of furniture to work off of that were reinforced with resin and MDF, but pieces that were not, that were to the proportions of objects in the collection of the Met Museum, from mostly donated by Morgan at the time, but that it didn't make any sense for me to get, say, a perfect antique replica. It was much more about this rendering of the objects, but creating sort of a sense of gesture in that. I also created this archway where there's a similar kind of messy molding on the edge. I wasn't able to source the custom molding as I wanted, so I ended up having to cast plaster for the columns, and then created the same texture in cast foam for the archway and modeled the front. Dealing with an object of this scale is kind of incredibly unwieldy and something we found in the out in the process. The works were then, the positives were shipped to New York. Silicone molds were made here at Sculpture House in Long Island City. We had a lot of conversations about how to deal with the parting lines and all of the technical aspects of the piece, and these are some of the works in the shop, and an image of the footstool as it's now cast. And then here's another image with some details on the chair. So you can see we've left intact some of the little carpet tacks that hold down the edge of the fabric. There's even a bit of a fabric-y texture from the fiberglass used to reinforce the piece. But then the sculptural kind of interpretation of the molding on the outside makes clear that it is not exactly the thing that it is based on. The works are installed at Doris Freedman Plaza, which is a huge honor to be there, in part because of the strong tradition of public art in New York, but in part thinking about Doris C. Freedman as this champion of public art before her time, the person that founded the Percentage for Art and has contributed so much to the legacy of public art in the city. I think one takes it for granted in some ways being here that public art is just a part of urban life in a great city, but in the fantastic city of Los Angeles I live in, we have absolutely zero infrastructure for it. So it's wonderful to be able to present the work here, also in relationship to this historic equestrian statue. One of the things that's strange about the piece for me is the juxtaposition in scale, and thinking about the scale of this project that did involve huge inputs from numerous people, whether it's the support of members of the board, of the Public Art Fund, the fabricators, the team in my studio, but how small this looks relative to the architecture of Manhattan. Thinking about the Manhattan skyline, and in the far right corner, you see, many of you have probably read about the battle over air rights around Central Park, and the fact that the piece is very often in shadow because the buildings grow increasingly tall. One of the questions I hope to raise with the piece is just the question of how urban space will be used in the future. How do we decide who has access to these spaces, and how much space do individual people need, and what happens in public space? The pieces are installed and intended to be fully interactive. So this morning we started photographing it early in the morning. This is the first time I've seen it with the fences removed from the site. And I should mention that everything has been engineered for people in their worst states to come and try to jostle them or interact, but everything is designed to withstand human force. So here you have a number of people have been taking photographs around the site, photographs with pets, eating lunch, long phone conversations. There's a woman that sat here for about 45 minutes talking on the phone. Another woman just lied down on the couch like it was her living room, and the photographer is waiting to get a shot. But it was actually just this wonderful moment where the fact that the boundary between public and private sort of collapsed, and that was one of the most interesting moments for me. So thank you so much.
So if we could have the house lights up a little bit, Liz is willing to entertain some questions. Does anyone have anything they want to ask or check? Maybe I could kick us off by bringing up the question of concrete. And we've been doing a lot of back and forth of these kinds of things. But I'm curious, Liz, to hear about your thoughts of why the material of concrete is so interesting for you as we wait for audience questions.
So these chairs were originally made of hand-carved wood and this very luxuriant tapestry fabric, textile, the damask textile. And I wanted to use concrete because it's sort of a material of the people. You see it, Le Corbusier used it in his first public housing projects. You saw it a lot in early modern architecture that had an ambition to house large numbers of people. And today you see it a lot in public parks or in modern architecture. Also think about in this piece the way that as it is an artifact of the past, it's very much about the present. And it was important for me to translate the piece and sort of turn it into something else.
Liz, congratulations. I mean, the piece is really extraordinary and wonderful to hear your thoughts about it and see how it has evolved out of the work you've done over the last few years. I think, you know, one thing that's very striking to me is how your aversion to the monolithic form, which is kind of what a lot of artists do in Doris Freedman Plaza, the kind of one grand statement on the axis of the pathway. And your piece really explodes that. And in a sense, this idea of kind of turning this plaza, which is quite a difficult space in the sense that, I mean, as you say, the scale of all the buildings of Midtown New York are, you know, so dominating. The street, I mean, you can see in this photograph, the road, you know, is right there. There's no kind of transition into the space. But by putting these arches, you know, you already kind of contain the space, and it somehow brings a completely different energy to that whole space and really activates it in a very different way. I'm just wondering if you can talk about kind of your thought process in arriving at that, and if the experience of, you know, installing the piece revealed anything to you about how that worked.
The piece was always about interiority and the set, creating a sense of interiority in public space. So there was actually an earlier version of the proposal, which you may or may not remember, that involved creating like a glass box that you maybe could experience the work from underneath or from the outside, but to really highlight that sense of an indoor-outdoor. But when we settled on that, was cost prohibitive, but also sort of unnecessary in some sense. And when we settled on Doris Freedman Plaza, what I always had, it took actually a couple years to settle on this as a site, because I often, when I visited it, felt sort of vulnerable on the corner there, or that the, because you have such a busy and well-trafficked corner that everyone is moving through it. So, I want the archways, which are actually based on the windows of the original house, were here they're rendered as archways, but deliberately leaving open where otherwise you would have the crossbars, kind of in the spirit of a Roman triumphal arch in some way, but really to create the sense of architecture and to delineate the idea that there is a space. This plaza is almost within about 10 feet in each direction, the dimensions of the original ballroom, and the archways felt really important to that, but as did the placement of the sofas on the far side of the plaza. I have a good view of it. Let's see, here. Having the sofa extend all the way out to the left-hand side, and the sofa itself as a mass kind of becomes the back of the space. My mother was an architect, but I tried once at the end of college to study architecture, but I found that I always was leaving one thing sort of open-ended, that I could never resolve a building design in a sense, but I still, I feel like when I work sculpturally, a lot of it is really spatial and involves walking around with a tape measure and not looking at the numbers and sort of holding something up to this height. And when we did the original plan for this install, there was a digital version of it, and I always mock the digital because it's not how I think. We came out with cardboard and sort of sat around and placed all these cardboard maquettes and kind of stood next to them to figure out how you wanted it to feel, how to make it feel like a room. We even had cardboard maquettes of the, I wish I had an image actually, of the archways to get a sense of that height. But it's, for me, it's about the relationship to the body and the body in space and how you could feel like you were inhabiting the room.
Thank you, this is so interesting and thought-provoking. You mentioned that you're research-based, and you've already listed Edith Wharton and the architectural history in Stanford White. Was it a year-long or many years process? What else went into your research?
It was about 2 years of research, but not 2 years constantly. Usually I'm working on maybe 3 or 4 different large-scale projects, and so they tend to overlap. I've spoken to Dan about this at length, because I often I have to read a ton about something, and then maybe have 6 months of not thinking about it too much and kind of forget a lot of what I've read, because otherwise the details are sort of too close to the surface. But then once the project is complete, I find myself having to go back and say, oh, what was the address of that ballroom, and or which house was it from, because I forget some of the small factual details in order to kind of get the bigger picture or decide what's important in the stake. But I read history, I read philosophy, I'm like a news junkie as well, but at the moment I'm researching like the history of technology, so I have just piles of books and economic theory on my bedside table.
Thank you. I'm thinking when you have school groups come, it's going to be the antithesis of kids don't play on the furniture. So is that going to be something that is encouraged so that the children know that it's something that they can do, or are you just going to wait and see how they react?
People seem to be reacting to all of it pretty naturally. It seems like there are about 3 first impulses. One is someone grabs it to see what it feels like and what it might be. The other is to take out the cell phone, and some people just sit down. No one that I saw today walked up and felt like do not touch. People seem to just intuitively, because there's no stanchion or anything preventing you, which is really exciting about the piece.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lynn. be a great presentation. Obviously, your practice is very intricate, cerebral, and to me, very invitingly tactile. But really what I want to ask is, I think in the PAF press release, it said this is your first major large-scale public installation. So did you approach this differently because of, number one, the amount of people who are going to see it because of its location, the diversity of the audience, and it's just such an important spot in New York, I think, as you referred to.
I think with a lot of the institutional projects I've done as well as this, there are, I'm very familiar with the concerns in a museum, like the, you know, ADA clearance, how much space you need to allow for a wheelchair to pass through, for example, or working with a structural engineer. Even in the case of the pyramid that I built, which was completely unsanctioned and done in someone's backyard, but with the support of a gallery in Los Angeles, with that work, I worked with a structural engineer just to confirm that it would be a safe structure. And safety is always a priority for me, even when I'm doing a small-scale off-site performance. And I think just in making sculpture and having to move it around and engaging physically with it myself, but even taking responsibility for the studio assistants I work with, I think a lot about a lot of those concerns just kind of feed into it. With the Public Art Fund, they have a significant infrastructure of engineers and a lot of the permissions that go through the parks and so forth. There were definitely a lot of... There's a lot of time invested in things that are sort of invisible, like creating a path that the snowplow could clear. And in any given installation, there are considerations like this. I'm working on a show for Mass MoCA where all of the overhead spaces have to have sprinklers for the fire in them. So I think each project is unique in that sense. But I do think with regard to the fact of it being in New York in such a... central location, I'll admit it's much, I feel a lot more stressed than I usually do about it. And I did think a lot about the history and sort of like, is this, it's a very important opportunity and a really an honor to have this platform, but what's an important thing to say with that platform and what do I want to say given this opportunity? So I think for me, the structural considerations sort of work themselves out, but it's more like the weight for me rests on the conceptual consideration.
Other questions?
Not quite a question, a comment. This piece has an interesting analog 30 blocks south where the church that Edith Jones became Edith Wharton burned in the winter a year or so ago. And so suddenly this interior space of the church was suddenly visible to the exterior. And the way that stone spalls in that kind of fire, it all becomes real rounded and really, so this finely carved stone suddenly looks like it's made out of poured concrete. It's like stacks, you know, concrete blocks. So I just mentioned this in passing, and I was wondering if you had happened to see the San Saba Church after it burned.
I haven't, but I would love to. One of my favorite monuments in Berlin is a church that's been destroyed several times by fire, whether by war or just by accident. And so it's the fourth time it burned, it was left intact. And think a lot about sites that kind of bear the effects of history and sort of the unintended consequences and how those marks are rendered on the object. But thank you, I will go visit.
I have a question. Hi, Liz. Thank you, that was really interesting to hear through your about your practice. But I know that a lot of the buildings that Stanford White made in the Gilded Age have now since been destroyed. I'm wondering, do you know in your research essentially what happened to all of the treasures and the fakes and everything that sort of went into making these elaborate ballrooms?
I don't, and it's actually one of the interesting qualities of them. I'm not sure if I mentioned this, but or I may have glossed over it, but the original furnishings, often White would get one or two Louis XIV chairs and then have them copied. So the chairs were sort of circa 1901 and not circa 17-something. And I've looked back through in terms of finding the images for the piece. There are objects that were not from Whitney's house of the period that came from houses that White did the interior decoration for in the collection of the Met. In terms of what happened to the contents of this house, I have no idea. But I think that there's this interesting untraceable aspect to that as to, like, is it valuable as furniture or do we give it a cultural value in a provenance?
You alluded to the problem of public space in New York, and especially in terms of, you know, those who have it and those who don't have it. I was just interested here, which relates to what Emma just said and what you just said about the building being destroyed. It being this private space that's been sort of eclipsed by the shadow of these larger buildings and prime real estate around Central Park. And sort of, in the, as you mentioned, literally in the shadow of these sort of taller buildings, many of which have been sort of problematic recently because of air rights for the super rich who are buying, you know, sort of the building on Central Park South, et cetera. I'm just sort of, I guess, kind of interested if you have any comments on that intersection between the sort of eclipse between historical private space being and this building sort of being within that intersection with on prime real estate in Central Park.
I mean, you feel it very physically in that space because it is so often in shade and it's cold and you're aware of the shadows of the other buildings, but also that there are cranes and scaffolding very much present in that neighborhood. And I think the fact that these buildings were, the building that this came out of was erected only 100 years before. And I believe, I'm trying to remember if it's 3 to 5 stories in height, but not much taller than that. And thinking about how rapidly suddenly 70 stories, you know, increase in scale, I guess for me the piece is, it's a question mark. It's sort of what happens next, or do we just keep building up, 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 and what will that look like and what will that feel like? And this is, it's actually also a question in LA at this moment because there are a lot of zoning ordinances asking whether we should build above one story in some neighborhoods. And so, but I think at the same time, there are questions about density in terms of the ability for denser spaces to provide housing to more people. So I'm not an urban planner, but I'm interested in using this as a point of departure to just ask who gets to decide those things, who should decide. Is it the person that lives at the top of that tower, or is the person who's standing on the ground? They might not, those might be the same people.
Hi, since the installation is temporary, what's gonna happen to the work? After?
The work will exist at the end. I don't know where it will go at this point, but yeah, the work, we'll see. I don't know yet, but the work will continue to exist either in an institutional private space or storage.
And I was also wondering, how did you decide of the distance between the different chairs? Because it seems close enough for people to acknowledge each other, but it doesn't create really an intimacy or between people, or does it?
The arrangement is based on this sort of happenstance historical photograph where it kind of feels like the party was over and people got up and pushed their chairs back to leave. So they're not quite as close as they might be for you to have a very intimate conversation, but there is this sense of the social. They're kind of grouped in groups of twos or threes, or they're one or two chairs just sort of off by their lonesome, as there was one that really struck me in the original photograph that it felt important to replicate, and that one faces out to Fifth Avenue. We did a couple things just for safety and engineering purposes, like we moved the footstools a little bit back from the chairs so you can rest your feet on them, but you can't use the force of your knee to kick them over. And some of the chairs are secured.
Maybe just one more question.
Thanks so much for such a great talk. I was curious about, your work is so wonderfully researched and meticulous in that respect, as well as others. But I'm curious about this piece, the new Public Art Fund work, seems such a lovely inversion of the Le Corbusier chair for the Carpenter Center that you can't sit on. But at the same time, I was thinking about the kind of maybe, I don't know if it's unwanted, but kind of illusions that come, the historical illusions that come along with it as a part of a design history. For example, how the Corb chair suddenly becomes minimalist, not modernist, and these seem to reference Memphis and a kind of Geoponte zone or a surrealist moment. Even thinking about Le Corbusier again in that project, I can't remember, that he did on the rooftop with the exterior fireplace and the exterior furniture in a residence, a very early project of his. So I'm just thinking about how you accommodate those kinds of illusions that come along with this.
Well, some stuff sort of, there's a lot that you can't control or anticipate in a sense, and I think I wasn't fully aware of how uncanny the translation into concrete would be, because we took great pains, for example, to maintain the roundness of the cushions. And just because of the fiberglass, which is used to reinforce, you actually have this fibrous texture. Even the way that the chipboard renders, there's still a little bit of texture which feels fabric-y. But at the same time, I don't like this term and don't know what to do with it, but a few people have sort of said it feels a little bit Disneyfied or something, that there is this, because they are freshly cast at this point, they have this slightly fake element because they're obviously not what they were intended to be. I mean, the other, this is kind of taking it out of an art historical realm, but I've thought a lot about how different periods of history or different aesthetics are leveraged in certain political contexts or aesthetic moments, like the way that under the Third Reich, the image of ancient Greece and Rome came up, or in the case of the Louis XIV furniture that's kind of come in and out of fashion for decor, so maybe with high design at the moment, you probably wouldn't see Louis XIV at the Trump Tower in the penthouse, you will. So the question is, and this piece was started 3 years ago, so thinking about when these aesthetics become, kind of fall in and out of fashion, I think, with your work as well, but thinking about, I think, both like stylized aesthetics and neglected aesthetics, but sort of when, what does someone represent by, even at the Gilded Age, what did they mean by taking up the image of Louis XIV? What were they trying to fashion themselves in the image of? So I think a lot about kind of the appropriation of those histories and the kind of recasting of them.
Do you feel like you kind of uncannily reproduce Trump's living room outside in New York?
I think we have more furniture.
Well, thank you all so much, and thank you, Liz.